after we learned about machine learning, let's talk a little bit more about the different categories of machine learning or different types of machine learning. The broadest or biggest category of machine learning is supervised learning. Supervised learning deals with labeled data, and in the case of the email spam classification, the labels were spam and not spam. And what we want to do is we want to predict the output, so our outcome, and the outcome is also the label itself. So we want to predict whether an email is spam or not spam on future emails. And there's also a direct feedback loop. So if we make a correct or wrong prediction, we use that information to improve the algorithm to make a better classification. So like I mentioned before, we have the term classification. So one subcategory of supervised learning is classification. So that is about learning how to assign class labels. In spam and not spam, we have the class labels, spam and not spam in email classification. In this figure here, we have two class labels, minus and plus. And the goal is to distinguish between minuses and pluses given two types of information, x1 and x2. So let's just imagine this is a continuous scale between, let's say, 0 and 10, and here 0 and 10. We have some numbers here, some measurements, and based on the x1 and x2 information, is this data point a minus or a plus? So that's the goal. And what the machine learning algorithm sees is these measurements, and it makes a prediction, and then we give it the label and say whether it's right or wrong. And over time, the machine learning algorithm will learn how to assign the correct label. And after seeing a lot of these examples, given this data set where we have plenty of examples, it may learn to draw this line here, which is the decision boundary. So if I have then a new data point, for example, let's put it here, everything right to the decision boundary would be classified as a plus. So this data point would be likely classified as a plus. If we have a data point here on the left-hand side, this would be likely classified as a minus. And the goal really is for the machine learning algorithm here to draw this decision boundary, because there are infinite ways to draw a decision boundary. So we could have one that is like here, but it's maybe not a good idea. Maybe here or here and so forth. And usually the machine learning algorithm is, or we define it like this, we train it such that it minimizes the number of making wrong predictions. So in this case, here this one would be a pretty good line, I would say. Another type of supervised learning algorithm is regression or regression analysis. So regression analysis, that's also a big field of research, as you may know from statistics, that deals with assigning a target output or outcome that is a continuous value. So before our target, let's call it target Y in classification, that was either, in the previous case, it was either a plus or a minus. By the way, it could be more than two classes. If we only have two classes, that would be this would be a case of what we call it binary classification, because binary from computer science, they are the binary value 0 or 1 or minus and plus in the case of the previous slide. So that would be a binary classification task where our output variable Y would be class label. In regression analysis here, Y is a continuous value. And the goal is given some input feature. So here I only have one input feature. So that would be a case, for example, where we may use a simple linear regression. That's a model with one input variable. And we want to predict the output Y. And for example, least squares regression would learn to fit a line through these points to minimize the offsets. So making a good prediction based on the mean squared error on all data points. And the key differences between classification and regression is regression deals with continuous values. So the Y here is really a continuous number. Could be also, let's say, on the scale from 0 to some arbitrary, let's say 100. It depends really on what your data is. You can also normalize that. So this is like a continuous value, not just labels like plus and minus. We just talked about supervised learning, which deals with labeled data. Now another category of machine learning is unsupervised learning. In unsupervised learning, we don't have any labels or only we don't have any target information. And we also don't have any real feedback, so we can't really measure how well the algorithm is doing and updating it based on that. So the goal really here is to find a hidden structure in the data. So to have unlabeled data and maybe find some patterns in the data. That's kind of the goal of unsupervised learning. One example of unsupervised learning is clustering. So imagine you have a data set, so where you have some measurements again like x1 and x2, but you don't have any class information, but you still maybe want to analyze something about the data. So in this case, if you just ignore the pink dotted lines here, what you would have are these different dots on the x1 and x2 axis, and you can see there are some dots like here, they are closer together to each other compared to dots over here. So you may think, okay, there's something about these dots that are maybe make them more related to other dots in this plot here. So you can say maybe this is a cluster, and maybe this is also a cluster. So you can assign these clusters based on some, let's say, densities or other ways of measuring it. There are many different ways of clustering, like k-means, dbScan, density-based clustering, or hierarchical clustering schemes, and so forth. So unsupervised learning is one part of it is clustering algorithms. That can be useful, for example, if you have a data set that is not labeled and you maybe want to group it in different types of categories. I mean, there are many, many different types of applications of that. Just so the idea here is the difference between supervised and unsupervised learning is really that in supervised learning we have labeled data, in unsupervised learning we have to make sense of a data set where we don't have any labeled information. Another common example of unsupervised learning is dimensionality reduction. There are supervised versions of it, but usually it's unsupervised. So dimensionality reduction, that is a case where we remove or reduce the number of features. So I don't want to go into too much detail here because we will have a dedicated lecture to this later on in this course. So here again, remember, this is just an introduction. I just want to briefly go over some examples or techniques so you have the big picture overview. So dimensionality reduction, like I said, is compressing features or reducing the number of features. If we had two features before, like x1 and x2, we could reduce that to a single feature, z, and we could do that by either dropping one of the features, or we could combine and transform or mix them in a way that we get a feature z that represents a feature that captures most of the information. That would be also one of the goals of principal component analysis, if you have heard of it. We'll discuss this later in this course. Either case, here I'm showing you an example applied to a data set called Swiss Roll. It's just a toy data set, but it's illustrating the problem where we have three features and we want to reduce it to two features while maintaining, let's say, the information about the features or the neighborhood of the features. So here in the Swiss roll, the data points that have a similar color are, let's say, closely related. And there are algorithms that can remove one of the features by combining. So it's merging in a certain way these features and transforming them such that we have a new two-dimensional space where the neighborhood between the points is still preserved. So you can see the red points are still very close together, similar to here, for example. So yeah, that would be one example of a feature transformation, or we also say feature extraction. Feature extraction is a subtype of dimensionality reduction. The other subtype would be feature selection. But we will cover this in way more detail later on. So let's get to the last category of machine learning, and that is reinforcement learning. Before, we had a labeled data set and or no labels, and we were just looking at the data points and just making a decision, for example, whether it's supposed to have a certain class label or whether it belongs to a cluster or not. In the case of dimensionality reduction, we didn't even assign anything, no cluster or class label, but we're just transforming features. Here now, what we are learning is a process, like a learning a series of actions. And for that, we use a reward system. So it sounds a little bit weird maybe. So let me show you a sketch of how the setup looks like. So also to give you maybe a hands-on example, let's consider the example of chess, where we want to play chess. And chess is very different if you think about it compared to classifying email as spam and non-spam. So there we had a label that we attached to email. Now we want to learn how to play chess, what kind of moves we have to perform to win or lose at the game. So we want to ideally win at the game. So what are the necessary moves here that we have to learn given a certain environment and state? So in chess, in order to learn the series of actions, we have an environment that would be our chessboard. I mean, just the pieces of the chessboard that we can move around and stuff like that. And the state is the current configuration of the board. So in where the pieces are on the chessboard. The agent that would be the player, in that case, the computer. And there's also a reward, whether we make a good move or not. So the reward, how it's defined, is a little bit tricky. So usually you start with some initial rewards for each move, and then you play a game, see whether your chess agent wins or not, and then based on that you update the rewards and so forth. So, and the action would be making a move on the chessboard. This is let's say the configuration where the chess pieces are. That is in a nutshell reinforcement learning. So we are learning a series of actions to win at chess, for example. There are many, many more examples. One popular type of example is now playing video games. For example, there are StarCraft players or old Atari games. So usually DeepMind works on that, where they develop agents to play at, on video games and stuff like that. This is out of the scope of this course. In this course, we are not talking about reinforcement learning. In my book, in the latest edition, but also in the last chapter, we have a whole chapter, like 30, 40 pages about reinforcement learning if you want to learn a bit about it, but it's really not required for this class because it's really a big topic, and there are special courses or courses just dedicated to reinforcement learning because it's just a broad topic. So in this course, reinforcement learning will not be covered, but if you're interested, you can read more about this in the Python machine learning book in the last chapter. Okay, so just to show you some examples of reinforcement learning. So here there's an agent that learns to run a parkour of like managing to run in a certain tricky environment that's trained by DeepMind. So this agent learns how to avoid certain obstacles, not hitting the red ones, or jumping and so forth. And how it learns it is by just trial and error. It would start out making some moves, the moves don't work well, the agent crashes into the obstacles and so forth, and then it would learn to become better at it. So that's one example of reinforcement learning. It's very popular in robotics, for example. Let's say Amazon warehouses, they use robots to find packages at certain locations and bring them to a destination. Or you probably also know the vacuum cleaners that move in your apartment or can move in your house and apartment to vacuum and avoid obstacles and learning the environment and so forth. Here's a maybe more interesting example. That is what happens when reinforcement learning fails. So you can see, quite some funny outcomes here. So also you can see the agents here are flapping their hands, which is very interesting, especially this one. I think that happens because there's no constraint really on what the robot has or agent has to do with the hands. So in this parkour setting, it just has to jump and move around. and there's no incentive maybe to put the hands in a certain position. And like I said, it's like a trial and error. If the agent learns to master the parkour and it gets through it and it does some random action with the hands, it's not kind of not a hindrance, it's not penalized for that, then it learns to do funny hand movements. Of course, you can also modify your algorithms to kind of have some additional constraints that shouldn't maybe use or waste energy by doing these weird movements and so forth. But yeah, that's just an example of reinforcement learning.